Welcome to my Boomer Buddies podcast, where we tell it like it was and is. Today, special guest, Boomer Buddy Tere Walsh. And we're also talking about a great old TV show that's still running today, one of the all-time classics, Perry Mason. You think of Perry Mason besides the theme song. What do you think of?
I think of 60s TV when I was a little girl. I remember my mom watching Perry Mason all the time, doing her ironing, and she just loved that show. Set in L.A., so it was very glamorous, as L.A. used to be in the 50s and 60s.
They had the awesome cars. They had the fashion. They had the film noir look, especially early on. Perry Mason, Paul Drake, Della Street were the main characters, and maybe you can tell us who played those parts.
Perry Mason, of course, was played by Raymond Burr. Della Street was played by Barbara Hale, and William Hopper played Paul Drake. And then there were two cast members that were well known, which was the DA, Hamilton Berger. He was played by William Talman. And Lieutenant Arthur Tragg was played by Ray Collins.
Lieutenant Arthur Tragg was kind of a curmudgeonly old veteran policeman, and he was always trying to catch Perry doing something illegal or something wrong. And I heard that Earl Stanley Gardner had him in his books, in his novels, as somebody the same age as Perry Mason. But when they saw Ray Collins, they said, you know what, he'd be good for this, and we'll just make him kind of a grandfatherly, fatherly type of guy in the show. And he was pretty special.
He's not too warm and loving like most grandpas.
No, but he sure came off like one of those 1930s, 40s guys from the film noir detective shows that you'd see with the hat and the trench coat, and pretty cool character. And you mentioned Hamilton Berger.
Yes.
Hamilton Berger, you know, when asked, hey, don't you get tired of losing all those cases to Perry Mason?
That question is incompetent, irrelevant, and immaterial.
He just replied, well, we were finding justice. Which is kind of refreshing to hear now, just so the truth comes out. And a lot of the episodes, they actually collaborated to find the truth, you know, between Berger and Tragg and Perry and Della and Paul Drake.
It was kind of weird seeing them working together. It didn't happen too often, but it did happen.
Justice was the end goal. So that was pretty cool.
That's good. Yes.
Well, the normal storyline, Terry, was that Perry Mason was an attorney who specialized in defending seemingly indefensible cases with the aid of his secretary, Della Street, and Paul Drake, of course, the investigator. And he often finds that digging deeply into the facts, other facts, startling facts, could be found. Often relying on his outstanding courtroom skills, he often tricks or traps people into unwittingly admitting their guilt. And that's kind of the way it went.
Yeah. There were a lot of people that got on that stand and thought they were going to get away with it. And next thing, they're telling what happened and just confessing and not stopping. I did it, and I did it like this. And
or another trick was he'd get somebody on the stand and he'd press them and basically kind of accuse them. And then whoever was in the audience that is the real guilty person couldn't take it anymore, and they'd stand up and yell out, and there it is. Yeah. Also, Terry, the formula that was in the books was basically a lot of the cases didn't even go to trial. It was in the preliminary hearings where all of this was sorted out.
Okay.
So the first half was basically you'd get the person that was either framed or not guilty, who was accused of being guilty, you'd get the backstory on all of that. And then the second half of it would be in the courtroom at the hearings. I'd like to go back and talk a little bit about the clothing. My grandma watched it, and I remember her watching it while I was there, and she loved the fashions, and she loved just the whole era. And she also liked to try to figure out the story.
I never figured out the story very often because it was, well, I was young, but it's been in reruns ever since it went off the air in 1966, I think it went off the air. Mm-hmm. And it's always someone weird. It's never the person you'd expect. So I don't know. Did Perry Mason's person he was representing, were they?
There were some episodes. There are three times the case of the terrified typist. That was season one, episode 38. And the case of the deadly verdict, season seven, episode four. And the case of the witless witness, where they were found guilty. And then there was one episode where the person was found guilty and going to go to the gas chamber. And then after the verdict, he found out, hey, she didn't do it. And he was able to get that corrected. Earl Stanley Gardner, the creator of the series, Terry, pretty interesting. He made an uncredited appearance in the last episode, the case of the final fade out. He actually appeared as the judge. And what they did is they took all the background people, the casting director, you know, some of the people on the set, and they put them in as characters, like a bartender or a waitress. And it was really cool how that turned out. So if you ever get a chance to see that episode, check it out. The case of the final fade out. That was the last one, and it was from 1966. As you mentioned, it was a long-running series. It went from 1957 to 66. And the casting director was Gail Patrick Jackson. And she was an actress back in the 30s and 40s. And she usually played the other woman or sometimes someone who just couldn't get a break. So she kind of understood all of those parts that were in a lot of the episodes, a lot of the books by Earl Stanley Gardner. And so she also liked to cast some people that she used to work with back in the theater. Gloria Henry, Vaughn Taylor, Hilary Brooke, John Archer, Morris Ancrum, Don Bedeau, Fay Wray, Olive Blakeney, Paul Fix, who played the sheriff in The Rifleman. He actually played the country attorney whenever the cases were outside of L.A. County. And another one was Addison Richards. So it's pretty cool how she went back to the people she knew and she casted them. And you have to admit, Terry, that the casting was pretty much spot on.
It was very good. I watched one a couple days ago and June Lockhart was the defendant. So it was kind of interesting to see her in a different role other than Timmy's mom, the farm wife on Lassie. She was a very glamorous and rich woman. So she's pretty versatile. And yeah, that was a good episode. And of course, she got off because Perry Mason was her attorney. So another right. thing, when you talked about going back to the fashion, another thing that's really funny that especially a younger generation today wouldn't see was smoking. They smoked everywhere. And some had the long cigarette holder, but they smoked in the office. They smoked in the car. And film noir, they're like that too. They're lighting cigarettes one right after the other. So
right.
interesting.
And also drinks. Alcohol. Yeah, martinis. If they would go to somebody's apartment, and one of the people, you know, that they had to defend, or even the bad guys, they always seem to have a wet bar there.
Yes,
you know, or a canter. Bar cart. That was interesting. Another thing that I noticed back then were the cars. Yeah. Man, they had some nice cars.
A lot of convertibles.
Paul Drake, he always had a convertible. He had a T-Bird. Oh, what else did he have? Let's see, fashions and the cars. Okay, 58 Bonneville. There was there's a Corvette there. What am I seeing? Continental convertible. Of course, they had a lot of Fords because I think Ford was the sponsor, especially in the early seasons. And another thing is Paul Drake also, he wore these sport coats that were different than anybody else you'd see on the series. They must have been pretty sporty back in the day, the tweeds.
Yes.
And then he also wore the coolest sunglasses. Yeah. They were Ray-Bans and they had the gold lenses and just
cool guy. He was pretty flashy in an understated way.
But, yeah.
Yeah, he had the plaid sports coats, the herringbone.
Yeah. He was also, Terry, portrayed as kind of a wolf, you know, kind of a ladies man. And he used to go in and he'd see Della and he'd say, how you doing, beautiful? That was kind of the running thing. And one question that pops up a lot in looking at the research here, were Della and Perry romantically involved?
Yeah.
And the answer is, in the books, yes.
Oh.
On the show, it was implied. It was just implicit. Yeah. And that was always, there's always that tension there.
Well, she certainly was a dedicated secretary. She, you know, if they had to go out at night, she was there. If they had to go do something, she was right there with them or on the phone researching something.
As the executive secretary, she was always there. In fact, she sat right at his desk at the corner taking notes. And when introduced, when a client would come in, or prospective client, he would introduce her as his executive secretary.
Here's a little tidbit about Barbara Hale. She was the mother of William Catt, who played back in the 80s, the greatest American hero. I thought that was interesting. He doesn't look anything like her. He doesn't have the same name. So,
no, he looks a lot like his dad, who was an actor. And it's interesting. He played Paul Drake. Her son played Paul Drake in the later, Paul Drake Jr., I think it was, in the later movies.
Oh, wow.
For a while. Yeah. That's a good tidbit. another thing is, remember in the early episodes, Gertie?
Yes.
Gertie was a secretary to Della Street. You know, she helped out. And that was played by Connie Kazan, Gertie. And that was the early seasons. Also, Lieutenant Tragg, you know, he was elderly when the show started. His health started failing. So what they did was they phased in a guy by the name of Wesley Lau, Lieutenant Anderson, or Andy. Yes. Is what they called him familiarly. And he did a good job. After Wesley Lau left, there was a guy by the name of Richard Anderson, an actor, character actor, who actually played in a couple episodes. He became Lieutenant Steve Drum.
Right. And so Richard Anderson's a very familiar face on TV dramas.
Oh, yeah. They're the character actors that they had. Some of the guests were on multiple times, four or five times. And if you watch it, if you're a serial repeat watcher of this classic show, you're going to see guys like Denver Pyle on there, a younger version of him. And Georgie Stone was on the most episodes. He was the court clerk, and he was 45 episodes.
Did he ever talk?
Yeah, he read the oath.
There's a lot of future stars that made appearances on there. You'll probably recall some of these people. Robert Redford was on there.
Oh, wow.
Barbara Eden.
Yes.
Burt Reynolds.
I remember him.
Marion Ross. Okay. The future Mrs. Cunningham on Happy Days. Dick Clark was even in an episode. He was known for something else, hosting Bandstand. And there's so many other people that came through there. But I really enjoyed how you would see people who were killed off on an episode, and then a couple years later, they're on again as a totally different character. It was pretty cool how they did that.
Another interesting fact about the show, Rick, was that the first season, it won a Primetime Emmy Award for Outstanding Dramatic Series. Raymond Burr, in the life of the show, won two Emmys for Outstanding Actor in a Dramatic Series, and Barbara Hale won one for Outstanding Supporting Actress in a Dramatic Series. So this was a popular series. It was number one show on CBS. It aired on Saturday nights. Well, then another channel, NBC, I believe it was, started running Bonanza against it. And that was not good. So they moved Perry Mason to Thursday nights. And it was a smash. That was a great move. So,
a move that worked out by the networks.
Yes.
That's good to hear that. Perry Mason episodes always had the beginning, the case of.
Yes.
And I know in the morning, I watch it on MeTV every morning, and then my wife and I watch it at night. And I try to catch the title, but I usually miss it. So I don't always put the title to what the episode is. So in looking up some things here, I said, I got to figure out how to tie these two together. So I went into the IMDb site, and I wanted to know what the 10 most popular episodes were from the series. Are you interested in hearing what they are?
I am.
Number 10 was The Case of the Wayward Wife. And if I describe it, maybe it'll come to you. Walking down the street, a Korean War veteran, Arthur Poe, is shocked to see a book about the war displayed, written, in quotes, by Ben Sutton, who was with him in the war. Now, the book is a bestseller, but is actually based on a diary that this guy, Poe, kept in the war. I remember that episode, and it was fantastic, The Case of the Wayward Wife. Number 9, The Case of the Moth-Eaten Mink. Now, that one was season 1, episode 13. And I'm trying to remember if this was the pilot episode that was actually played in episode 13. But in this one, Terry, Perry and Della are enjoying a quiet dinner at Maury Allen's restaurant when a waitress suddenly runs out and is hit by a car. Shots are fired, and Perry is left to hold a moth-eaten mink with just a pawn ticket hidden in it. So he had to unravel everything with that pawn ticket. Obviously, that was a key part.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember that one.
I kind of do. I remember the waitress getting hit by the car. Yeah.
And then number 8, this comes from season 8, episode 14. So this is one of the later seasons. The Case of the Ruinous Road. Adam Conrad, a junior engineer for a construction firm, is having some cost issues and covering issues with the boss, Joe Marshall. Joe frames Adam, the junior engineer, for embezzling, causing Adam to go looking for Joe, the boss. Joe is murdered, and of course, Adam is seen leaving the scene.
Yes,
all right.
I remember.
Another case that seems like a slam shut case that Perry solves. Okay, number 7. This is from season 4, episode 9. The Case of the 9 Dolls. This one is one of my wife's favorites. She mentioned it the other day. As Perry prepares to go to Scotland on vacation, a little girl arrives in his office and is asking him to determine who she is. His search takes him to Switzerland, where he meets a woman becomes his client after a murder. Okay, so every year on her birthday, a doll was sent to her in an orphanage. Of course, Perry finds out where it came from, and Paul Drake's in play. And that was a great episode.
I'll have to look that one up and watch it.
Yeah, The Case of the 9 Dolls.
Okay.
Number 6, season 5, episode 16, The Case of the Shapely Shadow. Janice Wainwright is a dedicated secretary to Marley Thielman, who becomes concerned when she learns he is being blackmailed. A lot of the episodes have blackmail.
Yes, yes.
Earl Stanley Gardner, he went to that one quite a bit. Perry advises her to follow through with her instructions, but it results in her being charged with his murder. Number 5, I remember this one. Season 6, episode 9, The Case of the Weary Watchdog. Della is on the hook to Perry for $25,000, but more importantly, may go to prison for helping a friend charged with murder who is being blackmailed, another blackmail case. Perry must not only prove his client, but his trusted secretary, Della Street, innocent as well. So that was number five in the top 10. Terry, this is number four. It's from season seven, episode one, The Case of the Nebulous Nephew. You ever wonder where they come up with these titles?
They're great, though. I love that all of them are The Case of
the Nebulous Nephew. John Brooks arrives at the elderly Stone sisters' home. They're spinsters, you know. That's a common theme, too.
Yes.
And, of course, the home is decorated like the 1800s, you know. And he knew a nephew who was declared illegitimate as a youth. Due to his recall of facts, they think he is really their nephew. Of course, it's really a scam. The guy is coached to know all this stuff.
Yes.
Ernest Stone is murdered in a tangled web of deceit. And that had a lot of things going on.
But I remember that one. It kind of reminded me the spinster sisters of arsenic and old lace.
Yes. Yeah. And the casting, again, was so good.
Yes.
Number three, season three, episode six, The Case of Paul Drake's Dilemma. This was a great episode. Perry Mason finds himself defending his private investigator, Paul Drake, against a charge of murder. It all began when Frank Thatcher hit a pedestrian walking on the sidewalk of the road and kills him. He hires Paul to pay off the widow. And then it goes from there.
I think I remember that one.
Number two, season seven, episode four. And this is a rare loss for Perry.
Oh.
The Case of the Deadly Verdict. In a very rare occurrence, Perry loses a case when Janice Barton is convicted of murdering her aunt and is subsequently sentenced to death. After the verdict, Perry still investigates to try to find out the real killer among the heirs. That's number two.
Okay.
And then here it is, number one.
The Case of the Final Fade-Out.
Season 9, episode 30. This is the last ever Perry episode. Barry Conrad has become a major star with an oversized ego. At the last moment, he tells his producer, Jackson Sidemark, that he won't be signing a new contract. Conrad, then Sidemark, are killed, giving Perry two clients back to back. And this is the episode where Earl Stanley Gardner actually plays the judge. Many of the staff on the show are in some form playing a part. Whether it's a bartender.
That's so fun after they've been working on the show for nine seasons. When Earl Stanley Gardner was not playing the judge, they had a pool of judges that they used. They had 12 different judges over the years. And interestingly enough, only one of them was a woman. Today you see many, many, many women judges. So
there's a lot to cover on here, Terry. And we tried to talk a little bit about things we remembered, and we also talked about things that we found in researching it. Perry Mason, to this day, remains a staple on TV. You can find it on MeTV a couple times a day. I think Sharon found it on Prime. Oh. And there's other places that you can watch Perry Mason.
Yes. Raymond Burr. Such a great actor. He did over 50 feature films. And, you know, a lot of times he played the bad guy, which you don't expect Perry Mason to play. He's just so versatile. They used to get 3,000 letters a week at the studio. 3,000 fan mail letters. And that wasn't emails because, of course, there weren't emails back then. When he got the job, he was 60 pounds overweight, and he made a commitment to lose the weight, and he did that. They tried to get him to come back. He did come back, but he made a deal that he would do Perry Mason Returns if he could do the movie Godzilla Returns, because he really liked that movie as well. So he did.
Right.
He was born in 1917. He weighed 12.75 ounces when he was born. He said he was a chubby kid. I never thought of him in Perry Mason as a chubby kid, but when I saw him in Ironside, I thought he was really in a wheelchair and he had gained all this weight, but I honestly thought he was. And interestingly enough, in 1993, he was in a wheelchair until he passed away that year. He couldn't, he was full time in a wheelchair. He made up a fake wife, Annette, and a son, Michael Evan, that were not, turned out not to be real. He said his son passed away, never said how. But interestingly enough, his last years were spent with a friend, Robert Benavidius, and they owned an orchid business together, and they owned some vineyards together. He had kept his private life very private. And those two, there's never any record of those two getting married, but he did leave his estate to Robert Benavidius. And some nieces and nephews went to court over that, but they didn't win. There was a will. And then he had renal cell carcinoma, which affected the kidneys and moved into his liver. And that's what ultimately took his life. He was handsome. All the ladies were swooning over him. Just charismatic. Such a charismatic.
Yeah, he had such a presence. And Earl Stanley Gardner, when he saw him, he said, "That's Perry Mason." His other people had tried out for the part. And during the show, Perry had some procedures done, some health things, and there were some guest stars that were on that basically for the episode, they were the lead attorney. Betty Davis.
Oh, wow.
She was on there. Michael Rennie, he played Klaatu in that science fiction movie, The Day the Earth Stood Still.
Okay.
And he's got an amazing presence on screen. And then Hugh O'Brien, he was in an episode that was really good. There's a doppelganger, somebody that looked just like him, and there's a lot of twists and turns in that little spy factor to it. And then, of course, one that I really liked was Walter Pidgeon. He was a guest attorney on there. Later on, Michael Connors substituted for him as well, and he went on to play Mannix in a show called Mannix, and he's got a great presence on screen as well.
Yes.
And another thing that I think we should mention is William Tallman was actually taken off the show for a while. And do you know the info on that?
Yes, he violated the moral clause of his contract. He was arrested after he was found at a party in a home with many people partially clothed and marijuana. He was taken off the show, and then Perry Mason and what was the producer's name? Jackson. They tried to get him back on the show. So after they went to bat for him, then after 10 months, he was put back on the show and remained there till the end of the season.
Yeah, that's Gail Patrick Jackson. And also, Terry, the way I understood it is the fans, millions of fans wrote in too,
yes,
wanted him back. Because nobody says his famous quote better. That's incompetent, irrelevant, and immaterial.
True. And it was.
That was said in so many episodes.
That question is incompetent, irrelevant, and immaterial.
He was a popular one, and he came back. And really, the best person for the DA. I mean, he was ruthless and kind of snotty. And
he had to be tenacious, yes. You know, Perry Mason was a formidable foe, and to go at him, and then sometimes you're just outflanked and made to look foolish, man, he would do the slow burn and and then continue on. He was a fighter. Yeah. But I also like we talked about a little bit ago, I also liked it when they worked together. And they started calling each other after hours by their first name, you know, Hamilton, Perry. Yeah. That was kind of fun to see. Or Lieutenant Anderson was Andy when they worked together. So you kind of had a comfortable feeling watching the show. That's part of the success. You knew the formula. You kind of knew how things would go about. And in the end, you weren't disappointed. There's very few episodes I didn't really care for. Just off the top of my head, there was one where they went to some missile base, and it seemed just a little far-fetched. And I liked it when they were in the courtroom. I liked it when they're also investigating along with the police force and trying to figure things out. It's kind of a cat and mouse, hiding the witness, you know, without doing it illegally, just in enough time so they can find out some things. Just well done. Earl Stanley Gardner, hats off to him. Wonderful author. And he was a lawyer too. So he knew the ins and outs. And then the casting by Gail Patrick Jackson, fabulous. And then all the way to whoever outfitted the characters, whoever found the cars, whoever did the hair and makeup, just all around great job. And I want to do a shout out to my neighbor, Mark Schumacher. He watches Leave It to Beaver and he watches Perry Mason every morning, just like somebody else, you know?
Yeah.
So the shout out to Mark. And you do too. Yeah. So there's millions of people that still enjoy Perry Mason, and that's wonderful. Yes. Do you have anything else you want to talk about? I know there's something I want to talk about.
Okay, you go ahead.
Your late husband, James Walsh, was a wonderful musician and fronted the band Gypsy, and he passed away about 13 months ago. And we commissioned an illustration of him, a piece of artwork, Joe Chesley and I. And we had it given to him at a lunch. We gave it to him, and he's so touched and moved by it. And I know we talked about this on other episodes of My Boomer Buddies podcast. But when he passed, we wanted you to have the ability to have some prints to offer to his fans out there. And I know there's thousands of his fans. And you have that print available, don't you?
I do have that print available. If people are interested, they can contact me at stew854, that's S-T-E-W 854, at hotmail.com, and I can tell them how to get one.
Okay, great. It's a wonderful piece, and I have the picture on the screen for those watching on YouTube and those listening on Spotify and Buzzsprout. Say the email address again, if you would, Terry.
stew854 at hotmail.com.
Great. And let's keep the music going of James Walsh and Gypsy. Fantastic. He was good to me when I was down and out, and he helped bring me back, and I'm just totally indebted to him forever. I'll love you, James, forever. And Terry, you've been great to me as well, and thank you. I love that you're part of the Boomer Buddies podcast. You're one of the Boomer Buddies, and we'll do another episode on something, probably music. If you could bring some of the band members from Gypsy onto this show, I think that would be great.
Yeah.
All the fans out there would love it. If you love music, you're going to love these guys. They're just consummate musicians and good guys.
Good guys, definitely. And James, I love you forever also. And James's fans, I think you really love this print. I've got it hanging in my dining room, and the artist is phenomenal. Yeah.
Bruce Peterson's the artist. Yes. Terry holds all the rights to the artwork, and it's wonderful. And also, there's a book coming out, too, and we can talk about that down the road, yes. Okay?
Sounds good.
Terry Walsh, My Boomer Buddies podcast.
Rick Reed, thanks for having me.
Always a pleasure. Always a pleasure. So, for Terry and myself, this has been My Boomer Buddies podcast. Until next time, we'll see you around the block. Hey, we hoped you enjoyed this episode featuring Perry Mason. What a great show.
Make sure that you subscribe, like, share on YouTube, tell some friends, and also catch us on Buzzsprout and on Spotify. Thanks again.